you're the hottest looking thing I've seen all morning. Can anyone see someone hotter on the other side of the sanctuary? You can change seats. I might need you to give me my glasses, Sarah, if you don't need my bag, they're in a black case. You know, it was awesome, and you've heard so much about colour, so here's the deal, you just got to position yourself. When there's a move of God on the earth, you don't want to get to heaven and go, oh, I missed it. And so all I'm saying is go make sure, 2017, I'm pumped because we're going to be found in the field. So I love being found in the mystery, but I want to be found where the lost people are, so there will never be one like next year. And so if you thought this year was good, with God, it just gets better and better and better. If you're a single guy, I would volunteer to serve. It's amazing. You have got at least 11,000 possibilities, potentially. Not if you're married, but just saying. Like, so it will be fantastic. I'm just part of the family, so I'm just your crazy aunt from down under, one of the convict colonies. So there you go. So I've just come back to the motherland. And I'm just going to jump into, we've had a great opportunity to celebrate what the Lord's done. But here's something He wants to do this morning in your life and in your heart. And I truly believe, you know, Jesus sees you. He knows what's going on. He knows what's going on in your heart, in your life, in your family. If you're married, with your spouse, with your children. And I think the Holy Spirit's going to do something deep in your heart right now. It's so funny, I must be getting older. It's like so dark, and I'm like, where are you? I do want to see you. So that's a sign of old age, that I actually need to wear glasses now to be able to read, because this is like I'm reading in the dark. I want you to turn with me to the book of Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7. I'm a bit Luke obsessed at the moment, and a great way to read scripture is just to read just a whole book of the Bible at a time. And the Bible was not written like one verse and let's just pause and just read it. But under the divine inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the writers would write a book. And so you really get a great overview when you read a book of the Bible at a time. So at the moment, I am obsessed with the book of Luke. And Dr. Luke was like an awesome guy. And I'm going to read from here, from this, just one story, and contextualize it, because I think there's a lot that we can learn from this. So in Luke chapter 7, verse 36, the Bible says, when one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Now, you can just even read this and think this is like really normal. But we could just pause there. There's a chick who was leading a sinful life, whatever that might mean. Commentators think that perhaps this means that she was a prostitute, but you know, most people lead a sinful life. And so she kind of turned up. It says she heard Jesus was at this place, so she came there. Now, the fact that nobody kicked her out or that she even knew where that place was suggests to me that maybe this wasn't the first time that she actually went there, which is interesting in and of itself, that why would this woman have been at Simon the Pharisee's house previously? So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume, and she stood behind him at his feet weeping. She began to wet his feet with the tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, and I want you to note that, he didn't say this to anyone else. He said it to himself. If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner. Jesus answered him, Simon, I've something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. Two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he forgave the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one that had the bigger debt forgiven. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You didn't give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little, loves little. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. The other guests began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." So this story is powerful on so many different levels. The fact is that Jesus has accepted a dinner invitation from a Pharisee, from a religious leader. That might seem normal, but you have to understand what's been happening. I mean, the book of Luke opens and talks about the fact that Jesus is coming, or that it prophesies the birth of the Messiah, and that there was 400 years of total silence where God was not speaking, and suddenly we're told that the Messiah is coming. Jesus is born, he's conceived supernaturally, he's born. Scripture begins to tell us about all these things that are happening. This, even as a 12-year-old boy, there's something very abnormal about him. He's in the temple, he ends up, you know, his parents have gone to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, they're going home, they lost Jesus, which is always very comforting as a mother to know that even Mary lost God. So you know it's okay if you've lost him. So there's something unusual about him anyway, even as a young boy. Then he begins to declare, this is what I've come. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to go into the fields and to begin to bring healing and hope and restoration to lost and broken people. He tells everyone today, this scripture from Isaiah has been fulfilled. This is what's happening, and I'm that person. So at that point, he's rejected. And people think, who are you? You are very, very strange. Then he goes about doing the things that he said he came to do. He begins healing the sick. He begins raising the dead. He begins forgiving sins. Now he's a highly controversial figure. And then he turns up, so Simon the Pharisee invites this highly controversial figure into his home for a meal. So he's already very, very strange, and people have been looking at him and people have been talking about him at this point in a whole lot of, they've been saying a whole lot of stuff about him. They have not recognized that this is the Messiah, this is the Son of God. We're reading this retrospectively and saying, wow, how amazing. Jesus is at dinner at Simon's house. The creator of the universe is in Simon's house, but Simon hasn't got a clue who's in his house. And so a woman learns that he's there. She's uninvited. She's unwanted. She's living a very, very controversial lifestyle, a very sinful lifestyle. She's probably promiscuous and immoral. And she ends up turning up at this dinner. Now look, just imagine, you're in Surrey, you're going to have dinner tonight. I just want you to think about this. Imagine some woman just randomly comes into your dinner table and just starts like weeping and washing feet. I mean, this is not like a normal moment. You know, we're just going to go, oh, this is awesome. But think about it. And not only that, it's the woman that maybe was running the brothel. You would think this is really strange. Now, it's interesting. No one stopped her from walking in. So you've got to wonder, had she been there before and why was she there before? But the thing is, she turns up at Simon's house. And this is all happening, and we're just kind of reading it like this is really normal, that some chick's going to come in at dinner, she's going to break open some perfume, pour it over your feet. Like, this is not normal. Nothing is normal in this dinner. So what happens is, Simon starts having a conversation with himself. He said to himself, if this man was a prophet, he would kind of know what she is, that she is a sinner. So he labels her, she's not a person, she's a sinner. He defines her by what she does, not who she is. And so he's going, if this man had any idea. And so this is what I find powerful, and really this is why I've come this morning. This one line in Luke 7:44, the Bible says, then Jesus, he turned towards the woman and he said to Simon. Jesus looks at the woman and speaks to Simon. It's quite a profound picture. That he's not looking at Simon when he's talking to him. He's looking at the woman. Because Simon has made all of these judgments. Simon has said, well, then obviously, this man's not a prophet. He doesn't even know what this woman does. He's looking at the woman. He doesn't see a woman. He just sees a sinner. He's having this whole conversation. I love it that Jesus answers him. It says, Simon's having a conversation with himself. But in verse 40, it says, Jesus answered him. Well, Simon wasn't talking to Jesus. Simon was talking to himself. And so I'm thinking, hashtag awkward, how would you feel if Jesus answers you because you've been thinking about something, but you never said it to Jesus. Jesus says, doo-doo-doo-doo, I know exactly what you're thinking. And he does, just in case you're wondering. And so at the end of the day, Simon's got this great kind of image, but he's thinking all of these thoughts like a lot of us do. And Jesus says, let me just answer you. And I'm going to answer you with this parable. they had a debt, one had a big debt, one had a little debt. Which one do you think is going to be more grateful? The one that has been forgiven their debt much? Well, that's exactly the same. And then Jesus turns around and he says, Simon, do you see this woman? Now, Simon's been talking about this woman. Simon has been looking at this woman. But it's one thing to look at something and another thing to see something. And we have a generation of people that are looking at a world, but they're not seeing a world. We're looking at situations, but we're not seeing people. We're looking at circumstances and we're labeling things, but we're not seeing people. And there is so much fear, and there is so much brokenness, and there is so much disunity, and there is so much disenfranchisement because we are looking but not seeing. And Jesus says, I need a generation that will see. Simon, do you see this woman? And I wonder what we see. I wonder as we walk down our streets and go into our normal lives, what is it that we are seeing? Because it's a profoundly probing question for Jesus to say, Simon, do you see this woman? Because you could look at something and see entirely the wrong thing. And I think this one question Jesus is asking us, well, what is it that you see? Simon has the creator of the universe sitting right there at his dinner table and doesn't recognize him. Because what happens is if you don't see people as Jesus sees people, you won't see Jesus for who he is. Simon didn't not only see the woman, he didn't see Jesus. And so a lot of times you could be sitting in a religious culture. You could be sitting at a meal. But if you're not looking the right way, you're not going to see the right thing. If you do not see people as Jesus sees people, you won't see Jesus as he's meant to be seen. And at the end of the day, he didn't see the woman, he didn't recognize Jesus. And I wonder sometimes under our religious fast where we think we're seeing Jesus, but we're missing people, I wonder if we're seeing Jesus. I really wonder. And a lot of the brokenness and fragmentation on the earth today and in our own personal relationships is because we're under the guise of, I see Jesus, I love Jesus, and I don't like people. And Jesus is like, what? I don't know who you're seeing, but you're not seeing me. Because if you don't see people, you don't see me. If you just see labels, you're not seeing me. If they're just that kind of person, they're just a refugee, they're just this, they're just that, then you are not seeing Jesus. Simon says, if he was a prophet, he'd see that she's a sinner. It's interesting, isn't it, that the woman saw Jesus for who he was and Simon missed him. And a lot of us, the religious ones, can miss Jesus for who he is because we don't see people for who they are. And lost and broken and fragmented people can recognize who Jesus is more than the church does. And so what we have to do is not only look, but see. Look, I don't know about you. I've been married for 20 years. And my husband has this incredible condition called domestic blindness, and it is incomprehensible to me. I mean, you know, Nick shoots clay pigeons. You know, like he's you know, don't get nervous. It's just the clays, and he's got a great line of sight. He can just shoot them up in the air. But if you ask him, did he see the socks, the 4,000 pairs that are in front of him? No. Or he can be standing at the refrigerator and he yells at me upstairs, Christine, where's the milk? It's like right there. It's amazing how you can look but not see. And you'll see what you want to see, but you can miss what God wants you to see. And so what we have to do is change the lens in our glasses. See, I think that Jesus suffers from a condition called love at first sight. I think Jesus looks at a broken and lost humanity and he just loves. For John 3:17, God did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Jesus has this condition, you know, in Christopher Marlowe in Hero and Leander, whoever loved that loved not at first sight. Shakespeare wrote it too, and because we're in England, you all love that. But anyway, so whoever loved that loved, and a lot of people, there's no such thing as love at first sight. I think Jesus suffers from love at first sight. I think Jesus looks at people and there's this sense of, I'm in love with them. He sees people for who they can be. But what do we see? when you're having conflict, in your relationships, in your workplace, do you just see a boss that you hate, or do you see a person created in the image of God that needs love and grace and redemption? That conflict that you're having in your interpersonal relationship with your spouse if you're married, what is it? Have you forgotten to see the person and all you see is the problem? Have you forgotten to see the fact that God can redeem, God can restore, God can reconcile, God can... Or do you just see the challenge? Do you just see the giants, or do you see the possibilities? Do you see the opportunity, or do you just see the blockages and the problems? What are you looking at and what are you seeing? Because looking and seeing are two different things. What we need to reclaim in the church is a love at first sight. That's what we need. Not just to aimlessly walk past people, but to truly, truly love them with all that is in us. You know, I grew up second generation migrant Greek in Australia. I certainly know what it is to be labelled and not seen. I certainly remember going to school, and I was just in Australia, you would have this term called the WOG, which is just a very derogatory term for an immigrant. And I don't even know that people called me my name for the first 10 years of my life. Not at school, not where I went to school, not in my neighborhood. I would walk in and my brothers, the other kids would beat him. You effing wog was basically what, you know, I would have thought my name was. And I would always think, like, if you only knew us. I mean, nowadays with my Big Fat Greek Wedding 1 and 2, like, it's cool to be Greek, but it was not cool to be Greek in Australia in the 70s and the 80s. It was not cool at all. Nowadays, you know, I could open a restaurant and people love feta cheese and people love olives and it's a delicacy and they pay a lot of money for it. But they used to laugh at me as the kids would eat their Vegemite sandwiches and I would eat my feta cheese sandwiches and they would mock us because of the smell of the feta cheese and I ended up just throwing them away every day because I didn't want to be called names. It's very painful to be labeled and not seen. It's very, very painful to just kind of go through life and no one stops to see who you are, to be judged but not spoken to be labeled but not known, to be rejected but not valued, to be categorized but not recognized. And that's how our world operates. And sometimes even, you know, it's easy to blame Simon, but I wonder what we're like. Because if we really truly want to see a world reconciled to God, then we are going to have to not be Simon, but we're going to have to be more like Jesus. Jesus says, do you see this? What do you see? I wonder, when we go to even a simple thing like the supermarket, do we see the person that's scanning our items? Or are we just like, I wish they would hurry up. Who are they? Do we see the person driving the bus? Do we see the people next to us? And it's this simple. Because the truth is, most of us don't. When we're reading a newspaper and reading, we just see categories of people. We don't want them in this country. We don't want this going on. We don't want that. Like they're just this objective something out there. Man, if this man was a prophet, he would know she was a sinner. Oh wow, if these people had a clue and they understood truly politics or economics or science or what, man, they would know. And the church is talking just like the world. Rather than go, hang on a minute, we see people. There is so much fear, there is so much terror, there is so much brokenness, there is so much fragmentation because we're not seeing. We've got to change the lenses in our spiritual glasses. You know, Sophia was really struggling at school, which was astounding to me because the kid is so bright. I mean, she can memorize monologues and I'm thinking, why are her grades declining? And so Nick and I went to school and we're kind of figuring this out and I'm thinking there's something not right, so we took her to an eye doctor, and it was amazing. Like, she literally could not read the words on the blackboard, and nobody, the teacher didn't recognize it, nobody knew. She couldn't see. So the minute she put glasses on, everything changed. Had a great show, and I remember that she put them on, she goes, Mummy, there's words. I mean, I cried. Mummy, there's words. I wonder how many of us are walking around and the lenses in our spiritual glasses are just fogged up, or we've got the wrong lens in there. And we don't realize, like, wow, Jesus' lenses are love and compassion and mercy and justice and truth, not judgment, not negativity, not fear, not terror, not doubt. We've got to change the lenses in our glasses. Simon, do you see this woman? Do you see? Some of you Your relationships are going to rapidly begin to change if you change the lenses in your glasses. Because you're seeing through the lens of judgment and offense and unforgiveness and bitterness and negativity and fear and doubt and anger and the lens of your past and the lens of your brokenness. You know, some people, maybe a past like mine, I came from a background where, you know, I was left in a hospital unnamed and unwanted. I was sexually abused for 12 years. Well, the truth is, if I didn't allow Jesus to bring redemption and healing and wholeness into my life, then I would be looking at everyone through the lens of my past and my brokenness and what had happened to me. And that's what happens to us. And some of us, our spouses are paying for something they never did to us because we haven't changed the lens in our glasses. Our children are paying for something they never did to us because we didn't change the lens. And we carry the offense and the unforgiveness and the bitterness. And we don't get involved in church life because in that last church, you don't know what they did. And we don't serve because you don't know what they did. And rather than looking through a purified, clean, redemptive lens, we're looking through the lens of our past, and we're allowing our past to define our future rather than putting God's lenses into our glasses. It needs to change. Imagine if I didn't do that. Imagine what my marriage would be like. If I didn't allow Jesus to come in and on a continual, ongoing, daily basis. This is why we stay in the Word every day, because I allow this Word to read me like a mirror. And it allows me to change the lens of how I look at everybody else. Otherwise, I would just carry the woundedness of my past into my present and into my future. But the fact is that God doesn't want us to do that. That's why Jesus, he says, I'm going to change some of those lenses. And if I can change that lens, then I'm going to change how you view people. First and foremost, because you're going to change how you see yourself. Because if you'll see me in the right way, you'll see you in the right way, and you'll see everybody else in the right way. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your strength, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. Most of us do love our neighbor as we love ourselves, we just don't like ourselves. And so if you don't like yourself, you have a flawed image of how you're viewing God. And God says, I need you to change the lens so that you can read the scripture, see yourself as I see you, then you'll see a broken humanity. Simon obviously didn't like himself, because in front of him was God incarnate, and he didn't see him. Didn't see him. Sometimes I wonder when people go, whoa, there's a move of God, how come you can't see it? Why haven't you registered? Why aren't you part of it? Why can't you see it? I think it's nothing new. 2,000 years ago, God incarnate walked on the earth, and people walked with him and didn't know him. So you can be in the middle of the move of God and not even see it. They were in the middle of walking with God and didn't even see him. Simon, do you see this woman? What is it that you see? Do you see only through the lens of your hurt and your offense or your selfishness? See, especially nowadays, Lord have mercy, in the age of the hashtag selfie, all we see is ourselves. We are the most narcissistic, self-absorbed, self-indulgent generation in history. 40 plus million hashtag selfie uploads a day. I mean, really, how much of ourselves do we want to see? You look at people's feeds and you go, oh my word, every second photo is you, 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 hashtag selfie. How absorbed with ourselves are we? How much more narcissistic do we need to become? It didn't work too well for us in Babel. Come, let us build a tower and make a name for ourselves. Gee, that works well. And the fact of the matter is, we're not here to make a name for ourselves. We're here to make a name for Jesus, because when you see Jesus, then you see yourself right, then you see the world right. Simon, what do you see? Do you see this woman? What do you see? You see, you only find yourself in him. Look, don't go out looking for yourself. All you're going to find is neurosis if you go looking for yourself. We have a nice self-help age that we live in. Now, I just want to find myself. I just want to find myself. Like, sweetheart, you're going to find neurosis, because you don't need to find you. You need to find Jesus. And in Jesus, you will find yourself. See, Simon didn't see Jesus, so he didn't see the woman. And you won't see a lost and a broken humanity, and you'll be caught up in legalism and dead works if you do not see Jesus through his word, and then you'll see yourself. And the best way to come to yourself is to go, wow, what does this word say? Maybe there's some stuff in my own heart I need to deal with. And then I'll stop seeing the problem in my husband or my wife or my kids or my boss or my church or my world and start realize that maybe it's me. Scripture just says maybe you need to just take the log out of your own eye before you start looking at the speck in everyone else's. We're blinded. We're blinded by the logs in our own eyes. And so we view everyone else through that, through our own prejudice, our own judgment, our own negativity, our own offense, our own bitterness, our own selfishness, our own lust, our own greed, and our own envy. And we define everyone else by how it's going to affect us. And Jesus said, if we're going to have an upside down kingdom, and just before Luke 7, there's all the Beatitudes in Luke 6, he goes, let me just redefine some things for you. This is not how the kingdom works. And we live in a world full of terror and pain and a world that is just insane, and it's not going to change. We have to change. And we change by bringing light and love and mercy and grace to a lost and a broken world. It's not some sort of philosophical concept. It's got to change internally so that we can bring an external change in our world. But it will be determined by what we see. Simon, do you see this woman? And you only see if the eyes of your heart, Ephesians says, Paul prays, I pray that the eyes of your heart are enlightened. We need as the church an enlightenment from the inside out. Not some Zen Buddhist enlightenment, sit on a rock, on our way to nothing, hugging a whale, kissing a tree, going to Nirvana in a Tirana, eating a piranha. That's not what I'm talking about. True enlightenment is only going to be found in the Word of God. And through an understanding that as we see Jesus more clearly and we magnify him and change our lenses, then we get a right view of us. And then we can have a right change. I think repentance, you're going to hear me preach a lot about this in the next couple of years. I think it's the greatest gift that God has given us. Because God's kindness leads us to repentance. And we've kind of steered away from that a lot in the church world because we think, I'm okay, you're okay, we're all okay, awesome, we're created in the image of God, I'm wonderful. You know what, we are in Christ wonderful, but outside of Christ, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, that we all need God's love and grace and mercy and forgiveness, and that if we think we've got nothing to repent from, then we have real issues, because God's kindness, what's repentance? It's turning around, it's a change of mind, it's a metanoia, it's I'm changing my mind. The greatest gift that God ever gave me was helping me to realize that I was dead in my sin and I needed to be made alive unto Christ. God did not come to make bad people good. He came to make dead people alive. And if there's no repentance, you don't know you're dead. You don't know you need life. And so it's a wonderful gift that God has given us that we go from death to it changes how you see everything. It changes how you see everything. But if all you see is, man, I'm okay and the problem's with everybody else, then we're just going to keep adding to the problem. And we're not going to bring any health or wholeness or healing. What do you see? Whatever crisis it is that you're confronting, whatever relational challenge it is that you have current, what is it that you see? Because are you seeing through the lens of your own selfishness, your own narcissism, your own greed, everything? What do you see? We need to change how we see and what we see so that we can change what we do. You know, when I first saw, I just think we started A21, and you look at it, what the Lord has done, it's miraculous. 14 offices around the world now. We've just been, Nick was in Iraq. He's just flying back today. He'll be in the services tonight as we start another office there. Our 100th rescue, and these are certified victims of human trafficking. Many hundreds more have been rescued, but we only ever announce the ones that are going through the legal system. And, you know, you'd be lucky if some organizations have two of those a year. So 100 already by April, we're just in the 1st of May, is miraculous. And so when I look at all it is, to God be the glory, truly. But why am I saying this? Because 9 years ago when I was standing at Thessaloniki Airport, there's a difference between looking and seeing. I had gone through the Kiev airport, I'd gone to Kala so many times, and gone up to Kiev to preach. I had seen posters in those airports too. I couldn't read Ukrainian, so I didn't know what it said. But there was women and children, I remember them. And I thought, I wonder what that is. Time as I go in and out of the airport, but when you're in a rush, and you're just all about your own business, you can look but not see. Then all of a sudden I'm standing in Thessaloniki and I can read Greek, so I could see in the posters it said missing, 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 and I'm seeing dozens of children and women. And all of a sudden I went from standing in a carousel waiting for my bags, looking at some posters, to seeing children. And I had just had Sophia, just had my second child at the time. I was 40. You know, if you pop out a kid at 40, man, you deserve a Purple Heart. I was not looking to start an anti-trafficking organization. I was looking to go to Santorini and have a holiday. You know, that's like it. But so most of us, we don't want to see, because when you see, it changes everything. When you see, there's a cost to seeing. And I think a lot of us don't want to pay the cost to seeing. It's easy to look because there's no cost at looking. That's why people look at porn. There's no cost. There's a huge cost on the other side of it, but oh, no, it's okay. But then when you see beyond the porn to that's someone's daughter, that's someone's sister, that's someone's mother, that's someone's brother, oh, you can no longer look at porn because you've seen. But if you don't see, you just keep looking. I'll move on. It got very quiet in this Presbyterian church right there, but I'll come and do another sermon. But that's what happens. That's what happens. You look but don't see. I'm just looking. Looking doesn't hurt. Exactly. Because looking doesn't lead to change. Seeing does. And so we need to change from looking to seeing. And looking, whether it comes to church life, whether it comes to other stuff that we're doing, we've got to begin to see. And I remember that I saw those posters and it was going to be very inconvenient to see. And I think a lot of churches, the reason they don't grow is because they're just not willing to be interrupted or inconvenienced. There is nothing convenient about revival. There is nothing convenient about doing nine colors at 50 years old. There is nothing convenient about waking up again and going for it. Nothing. Nothing. It's a huge interruption to your normal life. It's highly inconvenient to see people. Highly inconvenient to rearrange your table to include more people. Highly inconvenient to go out of your way and build a relationship. There is nothing convenient. But in our narcissistic world, we're in our self-indulgent world, where we think everything is supposed to relate around us. We want everything to be quick, easy, expedient, convenient, and it's all about me, 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 me. Hashtag selfie. It's all about me, but all for the glory of the Lord, of course. And so at the end of the day, it's all me, 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 me. And Jesus goes, I didn't come to make your life comfortable or convenient or safe. I came to make you dangerous to the kingdom of darkness. Now, dangerous to the kingdom of darkness does not mean standing on a stage, pointing a finger and being judgmental. It means that you're going to take your light into darkness and be highly inconvenienced, highly interrupted. It's going to mess your life upside down, but you laid down your life and you gave it to me anyway. So you know what? You are a living sacrifice. It's not easy to be a living dead person. It really isn't. I want to get up off the altar all the time. Oh, who wants to be like fried on an altar all the time? Praise the Lord. This is what Christianity is. It's actually that I laid down my life to follow Jesus. And I've given him my one and only life on this earth to take light and life into a lost and a broken world. It's not a some self-help, self-actualization program. It's not that he's going to wave a magic wand so that all of the world rotates around me. All of the world rotates around Jesus, not me. Which means I inconvenience myself to bring Jesus to a lost and a broken world. Jesus is the object. You see, it was convenient for Simon not to see Jesus because then he didn't have to see anybody else. We love to have religious feasts and invite Jesus to our table, but we don't want to make Jesus the center of our life because then we'd have to see everything else and change our life. So he goes, what do you see? I'm trying. What do you see? Because as we move forward out of the mystery into the fields, it's going to be really inconvenient. It's going to be really, your life is going to be really interrupted. There's going to be lots of things you don't like about it. Sounds so romantic because we think it's going to be a Wembley Arena full of everyday life of singing worship songs. Now, you're going to really need those worship songs to be able to survive with your interrupted and inconvenienced life. That's what's going to happen. You're really going to need to stir up that gift of the Holy Spirit on the inside of you to be able to exercise the fruits of the Spirit. And to be able to have a life full of love and joy and peace in the midst of chaos and turmoil and hatred and darkness and hopelessness. And that's where we bring the kingdom of God here on earth. that we bring love and joy and peace and kindness and gentleness and long-suffering and self-control. It's not that we have this artificial social construct that we call the church, totally disconnected from the world. That's not what this is. Sometimes that's what we think it is. Jesus says in John 17, says, Father, I do not pray that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by thy word, for your word is truth. As you sent me, I send them. Jesus sent us. That's where we are. That's our job profile. To bring heaven to earth in a lost and a broken and a dark world. Not to judge that world, not to condemn that world, but to bring life and hope and liberty into that world. But what we did was, Jesus said, I'm not of the world. So I'm going to come out from amongst them as ambiguist separatist. In King James, Englishist, of courseist. And then what we do is, we don't really know what it is. We're like Simon. Well, you know, I'm not like her, the sinner. I'm a Christian. I don't smoke, I don't drink, I don't cuss, I don't do anything. I wear beige because I'm a Christian. I'm a socially dysfunctional moron because I'm a Christian. I have no idea what I should be doing, but I know what I don't do. Bless the Lord. I define my whole Christianity by what I no longer do. No idea what I should be doing, but I don't do this. And that sinner, they do that. So I'm better than them because I don't do that. And so we've come out from amongst them, and we don't read our Bibles, so no one's got any idea that actually the sins that God talks about. Lust, greed, envy, gossip, slander. Of course, we don't gossip, we just pray for one another, don't we? And so it's, you know, it's... So we just excuse all that, but we're not a sinner like that woman. We've come out from amongst them to be ye as separatist. Over hereest. And I don't smoke and I don't drink, but gossip, slander, lie, cheating, selfishness, greed, envy, lust. See, the thing is that if you're here in the world but not of it, now have you ever noticed non-Christians know how Christians should be? So you have to really be a Christian. But to be over here, so rather than being here in the world but not of it, we're all over here. Of the world but not in it. It's awesome. So hard to change a world you're not in, even harder to change a world that you're the same substance as. And so what happens is over here, you don't even have to be a Christian, you just have to act like one for 1 hour on a Sunday. And the rest of the time, gossip, slander, envy, greed, lust, materialism, selfishness, chauvinism, sexism, racism. Awesome. As long as I can act like a Christian for an hour, I'm going to be excited. And then every now and again, the evangelist comes to town, and I'm like, gosh, Chris Kane's here. The Navy SEALs of the Christian church. Oh my gosh. And she just opened up the Bible to Matthew 28, the great suggestion. She's suggesting you've got nothing else to do today. You're going to go into all that evil world. And make it, but that's not my gift mix. That's not my calling. It's not my love language. It's not my strength finder. Also, we write Christian books to excuse Christians from being Christian. It's awesome. And so what happens is, that's for the elite troops. For the weird ones, they're going to get together on Friday night, have a little holy huddle. They're going to shun behind their Kawasaki, they're going to have their little prayer meeting, and they've got their full spiritual walls track, and that's for the elite troops of the church, and they're going to go into Surrey on Friday night because it's our evangelism night. And they've got their full spiritual walls track, and they're going to go in, bless God, we're going to release them to do that, and they're going to go into this dark world, and there's some poor guy just want to take his girlfriend out for dinner. But no, it's my evangelism night. So I'm going to shovel track you to stretch you on Jesus Christ, die for your sin, you're going to die and go to everlasting hell. And if you don't say this incantational prayer after me, you're gone. So quick, repeat this after me. And if you want to come 11 o'clock next Sunday, you can come and you can look like me, dance like me, sing like me. But I've got to run around because it's 10 o'clock at night now and I turned into a pumpkin, so I've got to run over here. And I'm going to put up this wall again and I'll put the drawbridge down and I'll put it back up. And I've done my evangelism, bless the Lord. And Jesus goes, I thought I asked you to be salt and light. Salt changes the very substance of something, but you can't change the substance of something you're the same substance as. Yeah. Light illuminates darkness. We're in a world that can't see because Christians can't see that world. Yeah. If we could see them, then they'll see the light of Christ in us, and they'll see Him. We don't go to them to shove a track down their throat. We go to illuminate the darkness and guide them to the light and the path, which is Jesus. We don't tell them a series of propositional truths. It's not some doctrine, you must believe this and say this after me. Whew, you're in, done. Because no, I need you to change this world by being in it but not of it. Simon, do you see this woman? No, I'm too busy in my little religious subculture, my artificial social construct called it the church. But the church was created to thrive in the womb of the world, connected to the kingdom through the power of the Holy Spirit. All our resource comes from heaven. It comes down there. So you've got so many churches on spiritual life support dying because we're putting all our resources, all our energy, all our time into trying to keep something alive. If you take a baby out of my womb prematurely and try to keep it alive after 3 months, eventually it's not going to stay alive. You've got to put it back in the womb of the world where we were created to thrive, connected to the Holy Spirit, where we can have a download from heaven. Everything from heaven, and we will have everything that we need. Simon, what do you see? Do you see that? Let me just finish with this. You know, my little girl, Sophia, she used to hate the dark. Still doesn't like it now. But one night I was just obsessed with flashlights, like torches. Absolutely. In England, is it flashlight or torch? Love you. On your mate. The same as Aussie. Okay, so it's a torch. And so I bought her, she was like about 3, a little Barbie torch. She was obsessed with Barbie at the time. If you said to her, Sophia, you know, do you have Jesus in your heart? She said, no, mummy. Daddy said we're not allowed to have boys. So I have got Barbie in my heart and Jesus in my tummy. So it was awesome. It was good theology in the Kane household. So anyway, so in the midst of all of that, I bought her this flashlight. We were in this big supermarket. And so I don't know if you've been in those supermarkets where they've got like all, the kind of lighting that I'm trying to think, fluorescent lighting. So it's so well lit. It's not like this right now. It's so well lit. And so Sophia's playing with a little Barbie torch and you could tell that she's frustrated because there's so much light, she couldn't see the light. So she's shining it, and eventually she just yells at me as I'm paying for the torch. She says, Mommy! Can we please go and find some darkness? When she said that, I froze. And I thought, out of the mouth of babes. And I thought, well, we're looking for more and more and more light to shine our already light in the already light. God's saying, hey, I want you to go and find some darkness. The only purpose of light is to illuminate the darkness. And if you take Sophia into a very dark room, then you know what? She's so scared. But if you give her a tiny little Barbie flashlight, and the kid will go into the darkest little corner because she understands it's not about the depth of the darkness around her. It's about the magnitude of the light within her to illuminate that darkness and bring healing and wholeness. And if we are going to allow our world to see Jesus, then we have got to change our lenses, get in the world, not be of the world, be holy people in the midst of a dark and iniquitous world. World, not be so cool and trendy so that the world thinks that we're cool. They don't need cool, they need Jesus. They need holiness, they need righteousness, they need to see Jesus. And so, will we be that generation that will be in it but not of it, and allow lost in a broken world to see a resurrected, risen Savior that lives on the inside of us? Simon, what do you see? Do you see this world? What do you see? Have you only seen religion and not Jesus? Simon had the creator of the universe at his table for dinner and didn't recognize him. You could be sitting in church every Sunday morning and have never recognized Jesus. Friend, I wonder if you know this Jesus that I'm talking about. Not do you know about him, but do you know him? And if you don't, right here, right now, I want to give you the opportunity to address the spiritual condition of your heart, the opportunity to put Jesus Christ first in your life. Friend, I'm not talking about religion. I made that very clear this morning. I'm talking about a relationship with Jesus. Friend, only Jesus Christ can give us forgiveness for our sins, a brand new start today, and a hope for the future. I want every head bowed and every eye closed, friend, wherever you're sitting, from the front to the back, from the left to the right. In this moment, I'm not speaking to the person next to you. I'm speaking to you. If you say, Chris, I want what you're talking about tonight, or this morning, I want a fresh start with Jesus Christ. either for the very first time, maybe a friend invited you into this place this morning and you kind of don't even really know how you ended up here. You know, just like that woman. It's okay, you've come to the table of Jesus and he sees you. He sees you and he sees you through the lenses of the glasses of love at first sight. He loves you. You might have walked in here and thought, man, I've done a whole lot of stuff wrong. How could Jesus love me? How could he love me? Friend, just like this woman, he didn't see the sinner, he saw a person. Right in this room this morning, Jesus could bring love and grace and compassion and mercy and forgiveness. Right here, right now. Maybe you've been sitting at the table of church, this one or some other one, in various capacities for weeks, months, maybe years. Or maybe you've been a little bit like Simon in this story. You've sat at the table, but you've never seen Jesus. And this morning your eyes have been opened. Your heart's throbbing. Something's different and you know it. Suddenly you're not only sitting at the table, but you've seen who's at the head of the table. And you want to surrender your life and your heart to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. So whether this is your very first time, or whether this is the first time that you're like, well, my eyes are open to Jesus. Christine, I want a fresh start with Jesus Christ this morning. I need forgiveness for my past. I want a brand new life today. I want a hope for the future. Then, friend, I want to pray for you. Just a simple but powerful prayer right there, right where you're sitting. And if you say, Chris, include me in that prayer this morning. I want a fresh start with Jesus Christ. Would you just raise your hand so I know who I'm praying for? Thank you. I'm seeing hands go up. Keep those hands going up. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Keep them going up. This is awesome. Keep your hands going up. This is fantastic. I'm seeing you right up at the very back. That's awesome. Put them up high because they made these rooms very dark for old people like me. This is awesome. Awesome. Hands are still going up. Beautiful, beautiful. Put them up high. This is so wonderful. Seeing whole families with their hands raised. Wonderful, wonderful. Young people, men, women. This is beautiful. Look at this. Holy Spirit's still drawing people to himself. You know it's you because your heart's thumping. I can see hands still going up. That's it. Keep your hands still going up. I'm going to give you 10 more seconds. Just raise your hand up really, really high so I can see. This beautiful. Look at that. Beautiful. Beautiful. Young and old, men and women. Wonderful. Keep your hand up high. I'm going to pray a prayer. Everyone in this room is going to pray this prayer out loud after me. Church, let's pray with conviction. Dear Jesus, I've raised my hand this morning because I recognize my need for you. I ask that you would forgive me for all of my sins. That you would give me a fresh start today and a hope for the future. I want to be a Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ every single day for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Can we thank God and stand to our feet? Come on, church. Let's stand to our feet and thank our wonderful Savior for people being saved. Come on, lift your hands to heaven and let's worship King Jesus. Let's see Jesus this morning.
to everyone here, our friends and our family, the bus driver, our boss, people at work, our work colleagues, at the school gate, Father. Lord, the people that we know, you love them, Father. You're so for them. And I pray, Lord, that we would get a heart for people. Lord, that we would actually see people. That our heart would be moved, Lord Jesus, to reach them and just do all that we can, Father, to invite them into our world, to make room at our table, to make room in our life, to make room for lunch and dinners, and really just help them, Father, be all that they can be in you, Lord Jesus. I pray, Lord, that we pray for opportunities to bring them back tonight at 5 p.m. to hear Christine preach, Lord Jesus, the 3 p.m. service. Father, do what only you can do. In your mighty name, amen. I would like you to come back this afternoon. We've got a 3 p.m., we've got a 5 p.m. service. You know, I think God's just getting started with what He wants to do in your life. Why don't you bring someone, make a night of it, bank holiday tomorrow. It's going to be incredible. Come on, why don't we sing one more song? Let's go, my set. Hands together, come on.
This is no performance, Lord.
If I sing for you, my King.